Portrait of an Artist, A Biography of Georgia O'Keeffe by Laurie Lisle. The book is subtitled A Biography of Georgia O'Keeffe. Chapter 1. Sun Prairie. Late in the autumn of 1887, the Sun Prairie Countryman, a rural Wisconsin newspaper, briefly noted that a baby girl had arrived 2 days before, on Tuesday, November 15th, in the farmhouse of Ida and Francis O'Keeffe. The birth, assisted by a country doctor in the O'Keeffe home, was the second for the young couple. The 23-year-old Ida named her infant Georgia Tato for her patrician Hungarian grandfather, George Tato. Georgia, it appeared, would have Ida's dark hair, and her round face was pure Irish like her father's. The variegated pigment of her eyes suggested the mingled bloodlines of brown-eyed maternal forebears and blue-eyed paternal ones. Georgia was born into a rapidly industrializing world. The country's longest suspension bridge, linking Brooklyn to Manhattan, had recently opened, and the Eiffel Tower in Paris was still under construction, due to be completed in 2 years. The American government in Washington, under the reformist leadership of President Grover Cleveland, was attempting to exert some control over capitalist monopolies and to bring order to the grim, oppressive factories, where immigrant laborers often erupted into violence and strikes. But in the western part of the country, the last great Indian War was still to be fought against federal troops. Little of this turmoil affected the pastoral life on the Sun Prairie farm, however. It remained, like farm life everywhere, suspended in a timeless ritual governed by the rhythms of nature. The newborn baby was kept indoors during the long, dark, icy northern winter. When the snow finally melted, the sunlight became warm, and the prairie was touched by the bright green of spring. Georgia was carried outside for the first time. She was placed on a handmade patchwork quilt, spread on the new grass and propped up by pillows. Those very first moments of seeing in the brilliant sunlight became indelibly etched in her memory. She precisely remembered the quilt's patterns of flowers on black and tiny red stars, as well as the startling blonde looks of her mother's friend. Yet another perception during those minutes in the pool of yellow sunshine was not so pleasant. Georgia, less than a year old, was acutely aware that two other children playing on the patterned quilt were getting all the admiration. One of them was her older brother, Francis Jr., 2 years old, the firstborn child with dark Tato eyes, who was adorable in his mama's eyes. When he was born, weighing a plump 10.5 pounds, it had been heralded as a grand event by the countrymen. As Georgia crawled around the cotton quilt, she felt a sharp sting of neglect. "Why doesn't anyone think I'm beautiful?" she recalled wondering many years later. She squirmed off the quilt, she remembered, and was impatiently thrust back onto it. Georgia's was a uniquely American heritage. Three of her grandparents were immigrants, and the fourth was descended from one of the earliest colonists in the New World. Her O'Keeffe grandparents had settled in Sun Prairie, first during the initial large wave of immigration to America. Pierce O'Keeffe and his wife, Catherine Mary, and other family members left for the American frontier when their family wool business in Ireland faltered. They arrived in Milwaukee through the chain of Great Lakes, then traveled directly west by oxcart for about 80 miles inland to the young settlement of Sun Prairie in the southern part of the state. In July 1848, Pierce O'Keeffe bought his first acres along the Koshkonong Creek from the federal government for less than $1 an acre. As he turned virgin forest into rolling farmland, his wife, Kate, gave birth to 4 sons, Boniface, Peter, Francis, and Bernard. The O'Keeffes began to homestead just 2 months after Wisconsin ceased being a territory and entered the Union as a state. Meanwhile, the last of the Winnebago Indians were being driven westward as the arriving farmers cut down the thick forests, plowed the hunting trails under, and decimated the deer. More and more land was being laid out in neatly numbered lots, and roads increasingly followed the straight lines of the surveyor's measure. At the same time, the railroads were inching into the newly settled regions to transport the wheat harvests and the iron ore to other parts of the country. About 10 years after the O'Keeffes had settled in Sun Prairie in 1848, George Victor Tato and his wife bought land next to the O'Keeffe farm.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.